Well, do we need to do a head count? Did everybody make it back from ziplining yesterday? You sure? Everyone made it. I couldn't go because I decided I'd jump back in and start the fall race season. And there was part of me all morning long that was waiting on that phone call. It's like, can you meet us at the emergency room? Because the more I heard, it's like, okay, so now where are you guys doing this at? Well, Bent Mountain. It's like, and how long's that been open? Well, it hasn't opened yet. And how much experience do these people have? Well, after we go, they'll have one full day of experience. But the videos were awesome. And those of you who have not went to the KOZ page, make sure you do that. And that's an actual page, right? No one can post it. It's just a page. But anyone can go to KOZ and look at just some of the fun that these older and younger guys have together. Just a blast. And I was watching the young guys, and they were having fun. But you dads were like, just going down there, just having a blast. And it was making me wish that I'd have went there instead of where I went. But I just appreciate you men taking the time to take these boys out and get their faces out from in front of a computer and out of a phone and away from technology. I know that's a no technology zone when you guys go out there and wherever you go, whether you're skinning deer, shooting bows or shooting guns or hiking, whatever you're doing. I know it's a leave your phones at home scenario, and I appreciate that so much. So I'm glad you guys have fun. Boy, what an eventful morning. And it was funny. I was telling some of the praise team this morning that just within minutes of things that began to unfold, and I was getting off by myself trying to figure out how to get to Williamson from here, and figured out there really wasn't a good way to get to Williamson from here. And I asked Clinton this morning, because he's a coal miner, he knows about those counties that I've never been. I said, so what's the best way to get to Williamson from here? And I said, I'm thinking 52. And he said, well, you can go over Herndon Mountain. I wouldn't do that. And it's like, so, because we want to go support the Southers family tonight with the loss of his dad. And at the same time, I'm getting all these dings and all these texts from praise team members who have stomach bugs and all this stuff. And I'm going, oh my gosh, I got to change the whole song list. And I'm trying to get my mind there. And then Jackie calls. And on that time of morning, on Sunday morning, I'm thinking, okay, did the roof fall in or did someone die? Because it's one of those two if he's calling me this early in the morning. And Joyce's mom had passed away. And it's like, oh my goodness, when it rains, it pours, doesn't it? But all of it, opportunities for us to be the body of Christ. Without these times, and I know nobody wants anything bad to ever happen. We want roses and cotton candy every day of our life. But I'm always remembering when Jesus is approached by, it was either a blind man or a cripple. I think it was a blind man. And the disciples said, whose fault is this? Was it his sin or his parents' sin? He said, neither. This is so the glory of God could be revealed here today. And these are times for us to shine. When people need comfort because of loss, how many has ever lost somebody close to you today? And I messaged Greg the other day, day before yesterday, when I found out this happened. And I just said, I'm so sorry. I've been in your shoes. I've lost a father. I know what you're feeling. And it's strength to people. We're not here just to learn the Word of God. We're here to process that Word of God and the Word become flesh in us, just like with Jesus. The Holy Spirit is our comforter, but He comforts through us, and He prospers through us, and He meets needs through us, and He meets prayers through us. And this is a season where I believe that God is going to raise the standard at Cornerstone Family Church and take us to a new level. All right, I want to go back, and I want to read at least part of the story that we read last week. I believe the Lord was here in a sovereign way opening up our hearts to see some things that maybe we take for granted. You know, we take getting saved for granted. Salvation, we take it for granted. All these catchphrases, born again, asking Jesus to come into my heart, sinner's prayers, altar calls, and it all becomes such churchy stuff that we don't even know what is going on inside of us. And last Sunday was a very precise time in our history that God said, we need to talk about this, and you need to see this and understand this in your own life, what has happened, or maybe for some, what has not happened yet, and you thought maybe it had just because you responded to an altar call or you repeated a sinner's prayer. And yet you looked at your life and you say, well, I don't really see any effect from that. And it was a good time for some truth to be revealed in our life. And I think we just need to build on this, and we need to understand. We need to understand how God works in our lives. The whole point of coming to church, discipleship, to understand how God is working in our lives and what our expectations should be based on that knowledge. I want to go back to this story about Jesus and Nick. And I want us to plow this field a little bit deeper this morning. Now, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a member of the Jewish ruling council. This guy was smart. He came to Jesus at night. And I stopped for just a second at that point last week, but I want you to understand what's going on here. This man is one of the kings of the Jewish religion. He knows the law inside and out. He is well-versed as you can get on every feast, every working part of the tabernacle, of the temple. This guy knows everything there is to know about religion. And religion is all they had at that point to try to identify God and understand God and figure out what God was trying to do with them. You can't get any smarter than Nicodemus when it came to religion. And he comes to Jesus at night, first of all, because he doesn't want those in his peer group to see it, because it would be embarrassing for someone as intelligent as him to go to this guy who has no education. They don't even know who he is. Half of them thinks he's a fruitcake. But what I want you to understand today is that he came to Jesus because with all that he knew, which was all there was to know about religion, he understood he had not found what he was looking for yet. There was more to the story, and he knew that he didn't know it. And Jesus had been talking and teaching, and Nicodemus had no doubt been hanging out in the shadows, and he'd been listening to the words of Jesus, and they were different. There was life in it. It was stirring something in his heart to the point that where this great, proud religious leader had to sneak away at night and have a conversation with this crude rebel redneck teacher that spoke Aramaic, the redneck language of the day. It says he came to him at night and said, Rabbi, by the way, we don't know how to appreciate that Nicodemus would call this Yeshua that had no claim to fame, definitely not in his family heritage, to call him rabbi. Was Nicodemus letting Jesus know, you have something I need? We know you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the miraculous signs you were doing if God were not with him. In reply, Jesus declared, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he's born again. And just freeze it there, because I want you to understand what's happening here. See, how many here are parents? And how many have ever had your children, a child, come to you, and the way that they're coming to you before they even open their mouth and say anything, you respond to them? And sometimes they walk up and you look at them and you go, no. Nope. I didn't say anything. I know what you're getting ready to say. Nope. This is the scenario you're witnessing here in this passage. Jesus knows why Nicodemus is coming. He knows what he's about to ask. Nicodemus has not asked anything yet. He's only substantiated, "I believe that you're from God. You know something I don't know. You've seen things I haven't seen." Jesus just instantly replies, "I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he's born again." And Nicodemus is like, "Well, I hadn't asked anything yet." Jesus understands the scenario. Nicodemus is coming to him, a teacher among teachers, a Pharisee among Pharisees. And he knows that he's coming to him because, with all of his knowledge, he does not feel like that he has made any connection with God. This thing hasn't been real. It's just been religion. It appears that Jesus has some kind of connection with God. He says, "We can see you are from God." He sees something in Jesus that he knows he doesn't have. Jesus knows, because he's such a great religious man. Let me paraphrase this so you can understand what he is saying. He's saying, "Nicodemus, you cannot see the things God wants you to see. You cannot understand the things that God needs you to understand unless you are born again. I can't just have an intellectual conversation with you and suddenly you understand the deep things of God. This can't be housed in an explanation. It can't be grasped because of human intellect and education unless you're born again." It continues on in verse 4, "How can a man be born when he is older?" Nicodemus asked. And that's a fair question. We look at it and we laugh, but put yourself in his shoes. I mean, come on, we would all think exactly what he thought. Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born. And Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit." And this was clearly understood to Nicodemus, this part, born of water, because in Jewish culture, that's how you referred to the literal physical birth of a human being. You're born of water. What precedes the baby coming out, ladies? The water breaks. That's why when pregnant women are on the stage, and here Erica's pregnant all over again, as she gets further along, it will be common for you to see a mop bucket setting up here. Just in case. And hot water on the stove. We don't know what that's all about. We just know you're supposed to boil hot water. Saint Nicodemus, if you want to understand what it is God is doing, because he keeps saying you cannot enter the kingdom of God, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. You know, Nicodemus has got to be saying, "I've never heard anyone talk like that. What are you talking about?" If you've been here for the parable study on Wednesday night, boy, are you going to understand the kingdom of God like you never understood the kingdom of God. Saying you can't enter the kingdom of God, this place of authority, this place of anointing, this place of identity, that's beyond the natural man. This place where there's order and there's majesty, and you're going to be a king, not just a teacher of the law, but a king. You can't enter this realm of relationship. You can't enter this just because you're born of water, a natural birth. You've got to be born of the Spirit, just like your physical man was born of water. There is something inside of you that has to be born of the Spirit. This is hard stuff for him to understand. It says, "Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to the Spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." Now, I got to freeze it there again. Remember who he's talking to. And even though Nicodemus would appear to be steeped more in the law than we are at Cornerstone Family Church, a grace church, I want you to understand what he's saying is, Nicodemus, you can't understand or connect with God based on the natural man through keeping the law, by keeping the Ten Commandments. You can't connect with God and understand what God's trying to do in you or in the earth just because you understand feasts and you keep the feasts and you know how to burn sacrifices and you know what kind of robes to wear and the order of this and the methods of that. This is all flesh stuff. That's stuff that you inherit being born of the water. You just understand the mechanics of how to do religion. But you can't enter the kingdom of God because you understand those things. He says, you've got to be born of the Spirit. And he says, you know what? The law, you always know what to eat, what not to eat, what to do, what not to do, where to go, where not to go, how to dress, how not to dress, what day to do this, what day not to do this. You can see this. It's all physical. You know what day, what season you're in with this feast and that feast, and you know these things. He says, but the Spirit's not like that. The natural man born of water, he knows how to do his religion and try to connect with God that way because he understands, okay, I do this and then I do this and I don't do this. He said, but that's not like the Spirit. The Spirit's like the wind. He's here, he's there. It's like, where's he at? You can't see it, but you feel the effect. He says, there's a birthing that has to take place in that realm. We're all birthed of water where we understand how to ring bells and how to punch buttons and how to eat that fruit and not eat that fruit. We understand those things. But he said, the birthing that has to take place for you to enter the realm of God can't be taught. You can't be educated into it. You can't be experienced into it. It's not inherited through the legacy of your parents and your grandparents. You have to be born of the Spirit, and the Spirit is not something that can be seen. You just feel the effect of it. I like later on when Jesus talks about the coming of the kingdom, he talks about the lightning flashing from the east to the west, and he's saying that's like the kingdom. It's here. No, it's there. Where's it at? You can't grab it. It's not tangible where you put your hands on it and hold it. It says you've got to be born again, born of the Spirit. Did I give you more than that? Was that it? That's it. That's all I need. So I can preach for 3 hours just off that. The Ruah. The Ruah, the very Spirit, the very wind of God introduced to us in the garden. The garden in Eden when God forms man from the dust of the earth. And the Bible says that he blows the Ruah of life into him. Interesting how that word Ruah is translated as wind and also translated as Spirit. That God blows something into the life of humanity, but that's not what you see. If you walk to the garden, that's not what you see. You see Adam. You see that which later on would be born of water. And you see that and you say, that's him. I know Adam. I see him. I recognize him. I recognize his features. But inside of Adam was the Ruah, the very Spirit of God. Something that had been dropped into the person of Adam. Now, this is a environment today where I'm assuming that everybody in here knows all about the birds and the bees. Do y'all know about the birds and the bees? When Hannah was like in the third grade, somewhere around there, she asked me something about where babies come from, and I was tiptoeing around some things and trying not to freak her out yet. And I ended up telling her, I said, baby, you'll understand this more when you get older, and I can tell you about the birds and the bees. And she says, Daddy, I already know about the birds and the bees. I said, well, tell me, what do you know about the birds and the bees? She said, birds fly and bees sting. I said, well, you are correct, ma'am. But there's a spiritual analogy that we'll get to later. Well, a few weeks ago, I'd put it off as long as I felt like it was safe to, and I knew what they were teaching at school and health class and stuff. And I also know that you get to a certain age, and if your teachers, if your instructors in some departments of life are your friends, you're in trouble. And isn't it funny how we all assume that our friends know what they're talking about when they tell us about the birds and the bees? So I sat Hannah down, and I was just waiting on her to go into shock or, you know, have an epileptic seizure or something. And I could tell I was telling her things that was not a news flash. Her lack of reaction told me she knew a lot of what I was already telling her. She hadn't put all the pieces together in her mind, so to speak. But she was getting it. Everybody in here understands that. I hope you do, at least at this point, and you teenagers, because you have such a great pastor, with Pastor Tim and Miss Pam, and just pouring into you. And I know the things that you guys talk about over there, and it's things sometimes that parents don't talk to kids about, and you guys do, and I so appreciate that. Everyone in this room understands the basic concept of how babies are made. Where do babies come from? And Paul said, first comes the natural and then the spiritual. And yes, Amber, you may need to take Aaron out of the room for this part. I was expecting one of the teenage boys to start giggling, but I'm pretty sure I hear Aaron over there. This is going to come as such a shock to you. And it's going to explain a lot of things, like your children. Yeah, the stork. The stork brings the cabbage patch child and puts it in the garden. Paul said first comes the natural and then the spiritual. And he was trying to help us understand that everything that we look at in life with just the way God made the ecology, the processes of that, the earth, the human body, identities we have as mother and father and friend and husband and wife, everything that God did in the natural, he didn't just throw those things out there and then later on say, you know what, I think I'll play off of that. That, you know, they've had fathers out there for about 600 years. You know what, I think I'll just play off that concept and I'll say, well, I'm your father. I just had a great idea. That's not how it worked. God took who he was, how he was, what he wanted to do, and he intentionally crafted creation where it could represent him in a way that we could relate. God already was going to be a father to us, and so he created what we know as natural fathers so we could identify back to God. And as our husband, and we as his bride, we as his children. God uses all those things intentionally. And the whole thing of, in the beginning, God made a man and God made a woman. And he was trying to tell us a story there when he said it's not good for Adam to be alone. He was telling us this is not just the story of Adam. This was the story of me. I was lonely. I wanted to share my existence with somebody. Adam is made in my image. That word Tesla means reflection. Adam is a reflection of who I am. His life will reflect some starting points here. And he reflected that God said, I want to share my life with somebody. And he made a man. And then he pulled out of him, out of Adam, a woman, just like he pulled out of himself us as human beings. And we would be very much alike and yet very different. Just as a woman is very much like a man biologically and yet very different, especially emotionally. He said, here's your picture of me and you right here. And I pulled from myself, my own DNA, and I've made you. And he made a man and he made a woman. And as you know, he made their body parts a little different. And as we say, he made the plumbing very intentional. And he created it where the man and the woman could come together as one, and there would be a deposit made. The man would place a deposit, a seed, inside that woman. That seed would travel into the deeper places of who that woman is. and it would land somewhere and it would cause a connection with something that had been inside of her for a long time, just dormant. You see, women have eggs inside of them, but if the eggs are never fertilized, it's something dormant inside of her body. It doesn't produce anything. But when the male makes the deposit and that seed that we call sperm travels into the deeper places of who that woman is and it finds that connection, suddenly that which was dormant instantly becomes life. Instantly. We believe that. What the world calls a blob, we call a baby. We're going into election time, and I will not change my stance, and I will not apologize to anybody every time there's an election season, and I tell you, there is one primary concern that America should always have before electing specific offices. Where do you stand on life? Because if you kill God's image, you will not be blessed. And if my king is not blessed, how can my nation be blessed? So people say, well, what about the economy? And what about this? And what about that? It's like, yes, those things matter. And they all have their place. But there's a starting point. And if you don't value and treasure and guard and protect what God would see as the most primary investment in creation, then does any of it matter? I'll take an idiot who preserves life over the most intelligent person on the planet who thinks it's just a blob. Kill it. It's not that important. We're the body of Christ. We think differently than the world. The world looks at us as idiots, and MSNBC will spend their life going out of their way to try to paint us as idiots because we don't think like them because we're not of this world. We're aliens. Oh, it's going to come around, those of you that actually look at your bulletin. That seed is deposited in that woman. I love the whole picture that is painted of the human soul. It comes from the Greek word psuche, which is where we get the female name Sue, or Suzanne, as my wife is actually named. And Susie and Susan. And it's a feminine name. And God is just trying to help us all understand that inside of every human being, whether you are male or female, biologically speaking, he wants us to understand as the bride of Christ, there's a part inside of you where there's something dormant waiting to be ignited and brought to life. There's a collision that has to take place. And Jesus is wanting Nicodemus to understand this, and it's hard for Nicodemus to understand it, and we can grab it much easier than Nicodemus can, and we can understand it much better than he was understanding. The question is, have we taken our faith into that place and joined it with our knowledge in the revelation for us to really grab the truth that Jesus called the truth in this story? You see, we would be conditioned to feel like that, okay, I'm a sinner, I'm just lost, I went to church, I heard something that stirred me, moved me, or scared me, I responded to an altar, I went up there, I repeated a sinner's prayer, and now I'm going back to my chair and I'm saved, I'm born again. And now they say, but you've got to come to church because we need to teach you, we need to discipline you. And so we take Jesus and we start adding a bunch of stuff to it. And we say, now, since you're a Christian, now you no longer should do this, and you have to start doing this. And we give them the list of, here's the things you now need to start doing, and here's the list of things you need to stop doing. And that's how we disciple people. And so our thought is, Jesus just came into my heart, and that's where he's going to live, and that's where he's going to stay. And now my job is, since Jesus came into my heart, I must now master my flesh and discipline my flesh and teach my flesh to act like Jesus who's inside of me. And that is not the truth. The truth is, your flesh is filled with unrighteousness, and it always will be. Paul, a much better man than me, confessed that his flesh will always be his flesh. It will always be at enmity with God. It's not about, just as we would think, disciplining the flesh and make it an imitator of Jesus and teach me to act like a Christian. You will not find success. You will only find frustration in that process. The truth is, Jesus said, what is born of flesh or of water, it's flesh. It takes a completely different birthing. You can't just take the flesh and add some law, add some feasts, add some rituals, add some temple stuff to it, and suddenly now you're making a connection with God. He's saying, what was born of flesh? It's born of flesh. Later on, when we get this other birthing out, we get it out of the womb, out, push this thing out, we'll deal with that was born of water later. But for now, that's not our issue. And Jesus is trying to tell Nicodemus, this thing is different. It takes a born again, a fresh birthing. It's born of spirit. How do we understand that? We understand it because God gives us the pattern. He gives us the analogy of a man and a woman, and they're coming together just like God and a human being comes together, and suddenly that human being is drawn. We tell the story of Song of Solomon all the time. I touched back on it last week, the story of King Solomon as he's out traveling one day. He gets in his carriage or he's on his horse and he's traveling through the countryside, through the fields there that are being worked. And there's a bunch of women out there and they're working in the fields. And there's this one Shulamite woman. They're all a bunch of Shulamite women, but there's this one in particular that somehow he catches her eye and she catches his eye. And it would appear, though the story has a lot of detail left out, it's not that hard to fill in the blanks of the story and what's going on. He is traveling through the farm areas and he sees this woman and he must stop and he must be starting a conversation with her. And she's not feeling worthy for him, the king, to be talking to her. She's been out in the sun working, and so her skin is not lily white anymore. She's got a tan. Opposite culture of us. And my wife, we were always talking about people at the beach that are wearing things that they probably shouldn't be wearing. And then again, on the other hand, it's kind of cool to me that people feel so free to just say, you know what, I don't care what anyone thinks. I'm getting a tan today, baby. I like that. I don't exactly have a Hercules body myself. Close, but not quite. And my wife says, well, tan fat looks better than white fat. And I'm thinking, you know what? That's true, and it's even true with skinny people. Get a tan and you suddenly look better. That's not how it worked in that culture. If you wanted to be considered a beautiful woman, you could not be out in the sun. You had to cover your skin. She said, I'm dark. He said, yeah, you're dark, you're tan, but you're lovely. She said, I'm a rose of Sharon. I'm a lily of the valley. I'm common. Walk out in this pasture. You'll see these common weed-type flowering weeds. You'll see them anywhere you go in the pasture. None of them stands out. They're common. They're a dime a dozen. He said, no, baby, you're beautiful to me. She's saying, I'm ugly. I'm picturing this Seinfeld episode when Kramer went on this smoking binge. You remember that one? His teeth are all gnarly and brown and his skin's all wrinkled, looks like leather. And he says, don't look at me, I'm hideous. How many knows that scene? Is that not? It's awesome. And that's what she's doing. Don't look at me. I'm dark. I'm common. Well, the saga continues, and we don't know exactly what's been going on here, but next thing we know, she's in her bedchamber. She has washed her feet. She's washed herself. She's put on her bed garments, and she's in bed, and the king comes knocking. Knocking on what? The bedchamber's door. It's like, who is it? He does something we wouldn't do today. There's a little latched entry place that's just big enough for a human hand, and he opens it and he thrusts his hand through the door. If we can spiritually see this, the hand of God being extended towards us. And the story says she knew it was the king because she smelt his fragrance. You didn't have to be a rocket scientist to know why he was there. The king was ready to get intimate. The king was ready to make a deposit. The king was ready to produce life in that woman. And you know what she said? She said, I've already washed myself. I'm already clean. Should I get up and dirty myself by coming to the door and letting you in? And she spoke for a huge percentage of the body of Christ when she said, I went to this altar, I said the sinner's prayer, they said I'm clean, I'm a Christian now. Do I really need to get up, come to your outstretched hand, come to you, and let you in to the place of intimacy, into my bed? That's the way the American Christian thinks. I'm clean. I'm ready to go. Even so, come Lord Jesus. God's like, but that's your American Christian version. That's not the plan. Y'all are like Nicodemus. Y'all don't have a clue what's going on here. The plan is that I come to you and I deposit my seed into you. Solomon said, inside of you, oh dear, is a garden. He told her that. What's he doing? He's prophesying. He's trying to make us understand we are the garden of God. We are that Shulamite woman. And God's wanting to get intimate and personal. It's not about getting saved. It's not about sinners' prayers and altar calls. It's about getting up and opening the door and let him into my soul, where he will drop seed that will begin to produce life, where there's going to be a brand new person born. I can't condition my old man. I have to have a new man born again. So we hear the word, and if you've been here on Wednesday nights, you understand that all these parables about seed, it wasn't about just any seed. Jesus was very specific from the very first parable. He said, the seed is the teaching of the kingdom of God. It's all good. The Bible's good. We need all this stuff from Genesis on, but that's not what Jesus was talking about. He was talking about something they had never heard before. The kingdom of God had never been preached before, had never been taught before. They didn't have a clue what he was talking about. He said, I have come. He said, I'm the farmer. You are the field, and I am coming to scatter seed in you that's never been in your soil before. It's going to grow something, produce something you've never had before. Say, Nicodemus, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, the realm of God, the place where God dwells, where you have his authority and his anointing and his power and his righteousness and his peace and his joy and life abundantly, that realm, that kingdom, you can't just condition your old man with religion. You've got to be born again, born of the Spirit. You've got to let me drop some seed in you that's never been in you before, and you've got to let it grow, and you've got to let that thing become something, and then you've got to push this thing out. And boy, did Isaiah ever prophesy about that. That barren woman who never had a baby. He said, rejoice and sing. He said, because you who've never had a child, never even had a husband, you're about to get a husband and you're about to have a baby. And this thing's going to be deposited in you. It's going to make a connection in you. It's going to begin to grow something in you that's never been inside of you before. It's going to get bigger and bigger till it's going to be like fire shut up in your bones. One of the songs I'd pulled for this morning, and Mark texted me early and said, man, I got the stomach bug, and I needed him on this. It's one of the few songs that I need him and Clinton both with what they're doing to make the song work. It's a song like a fire shut up in my bones. I want the world to know you are God. And that's the way the prophet described it. It's like fire shut up in my bones. There's something inside of me, and I feel it kicking, and I feel it moving. And you ladies that have had babies, oh, how intimate your knowledge of God should be as you can relate to the whole process of what God is trying to do in us. I want to tell you today that I believe that more of you than not, if not all of you, have been in a situation where the farmer has deposited seed inside of you. You've heard something. You've been in situations. You've been in scenarios here and other places even before you got here. And those deposits have been made in you. And now, I feel like one of my primary roles is to figure out how to not just put you in an atmosphere where the seed can go in you, but help you retain that seed. Because here's what I am seeing over and over and over again through 33 years of ministry. I'm seeing God place deposits inside of people to begin that born again experience. But the baby never gets full term, and it never gets pushed out, and it never becomes the new man that Paul talks about begins to take over the old man. You see, it's a process of this thing has to be, there has to be a conception. And we said last week, so what's the point where we can say, I got saved? I don't know. Whenever the conception took place is when the life started. That's all I can tell you. And I am not the judge. I don't know when that happened in you. I just am pretty sure I know when it happened in me. And the problem is that I'm seeing way too many people in the body of Christ that never actually get to the point of that new child in them, that whole thing that was pictured through the coming of Jesus himself with the whole virgin birth, with the whole thing with Mary having something grow inside of her that was not of man, was not of flesh. The Bible says it was born of the Spirit. She was impregnated of the Spirit. It was the picture of what Jesus is talking about to Nicodemus, where God himself plants a seed inside of you and it begins to grow. And if it can be pushed out, when you push it out, it is the Christ. It's no longer us that lives, but it's Christ that lives in us. That's not a little Jesus. That's Christ. The very anointing of God is what Christ means. And with so many people, I'm seeing that the pregnancy isn't even going full term where they can push this baby out so they can get to the point where the flesh and the spirit man can wrestle and battle to where two wolves are at it, full blown. But we're feeding the good wolf, we're feeding the good wolf, we're feeding the good wolf, and he's taken over. And now there's more of him and less of me. He's increasing and I'm decreasing. And before you know it, I can say, I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. And that's when life becomes more than just a Christian catchphrase. It becomes your identity. One of the first things I see going on is that abortion in the body of Christ is rampant. And I preached a message years ago at a Full Gospel businessmen's meeting down in somewhere in the Tidewater area. I don't remember. I was in that area so much, and it's all just a big blur anymore. But I'll never forget that night that, and it was the only time I'd really ever talked about how the Lord was showing me that every bad thing going on in the natural and the earth was only just a spiritual reflection of what was going on in the body of Christ. And I began to pull things out like abortion. Why is abortion getting so bad in the natural? Because it's just reflecting what's going on in the spirit realm. Everything in the natural only reflects what's going on in the spirit realm, because the spirit realm is the real realm. That's where God is. And I see that God makes these deposits in us. And his seed is in us and it's trying to grow. And for whatever reason, we decide we don't want the responsibility of that thing. And so we abort it. We make intentional decisions An abortion is not like a miscarriage. And I'm not here to judge anyone that may be here that's had an abortion. His grace abounds in your life. You no doubt allowed God to teach you incredible things through that where you are not even who you were then. Just stay with my analogy and please don't personalize it if that is your case. The difference between an abortion and a miscarriage is an abortion is an intentional decision to say, I don't want this baby. And we do it all the time in the body of Christ. The seed is planted. It begins to grow. We begin to think about the responsibility because everybody wants to go to heaven, but not everybody wants to serve. Not everybody wants to give their life away. Not everyone wants to deny themselves and pick up a cross and follow Jesus. Everybody wants to add God to their life, but they don't want to add their life to God. Everybody wants God to show up and fix everything, but to completely surrender is a different story. And so we intentionally abort the fetus before it ever has time to become something of significance in our life. The other thing that I have seen happen is spiritual miscarriages in people all the time. My wife and I have been through miscarriages. That is something we can relate to. And sometimes you don't know what's causing the miscarriage. I remember, we don't even know how many, when I say small miscarriages, what I mean really close to the front end where you women know you can have a miscarriage and not even be aware of it, right? Because it's so close to the front end of that thing. And it happens all the time, doctors say. And those times that you carry that thing far enough where, I mean, you're listening to heartbeats and you're looking at things on monitors and you're going, there's my child, man, there's my kid. You're seeing eyeballs and big fat heads and all kinds of things. And does it not look like an alien? Seriously. We've been there, and I remember the first time that we had we've had two miscarriages that were really significant because it was that far along, and the last one, in fact, Hannah would not be the youngest one in the house right now if that last one would have stuck because we were pregnant with child as we were getting ready to go to China to get Hannah, and the first one. Boy, the first one was, for me, the biggest heartbreaker of all because, you know, just all your eggs are in that basket, no pun intended. And you know, you go to the doctor and you listen to the heartbeat and you see the heartbeat and it's like, you know, it's fast, man. And you're looking at it and you're just all excited and everything. And then you find yourself in the ER going, something's wrong, and then everything falls apart. And I remember Dr. Nito, it was before he passed away, and he was our doctor, and he set us down, and he tried to comfort us by explaining to us, you know, sometimes there's something wrong in the mother's body, and we don't always know what it is. But somehow God made the human body where it knows something's not right. This pregnancy cannot be carried full term. It will not be right. We need to abort this thing right now, abort the mission, because this isn't going to be good. And of course, I do trust God with that. Absolutely, God designed us that way. But we never had the explanation. She never knew why she couldn't carry a baby full term. But the problem is there's many times that there are miscarriages where we, as the humans, as the mothers especially, are 100% in control. I was somewhere just last week, and I saw this woman who was very, very pregnant, standing on a corner, sucking on a cigarette about that long. And I just wanted to jump out, punch her in the belly as hard as I could, see if I could squirt that thing out and save it while I could and take it home. It's like, what is wrong with you? Women who won't take their prenatal vitamins. I remember we go to the doctor and they put her on all kinds of prenatal vitamins saying, you know, you need extra this and extra that. And women who don't, you know, they don't watch what they eat and how they eat and with the exercise and people who just, they're pregnant, the deposit's been made, it's in there, but they're really not taking care of that thing so it can begin to grow and be healthy. And we do that all the time in the body of Christ. We go to the altar, we say a sinner's prayer, we start going to church. God has put a deposit in us, but you know, most of you women have been pregnant before. How many of you ladies would agree with me that, because I remember when I was pregnant, how many of you ladies would agree that once you became pregnant, that everything in life began to revolve around that pregnancy? Everything. I mean, emotionally, physically, just relationally, everything was about the pregnancy now. We do that in the natural. I mean, when Erica found out a few weeks ago that she was pregnant again, instantly, she's with her doctor and she's like, okay, I was going to do this race and I was going to do that. Should I do that? How much should I run? She instantly is gathering information that will make sure that life that's growing in her is going to continue. Now, I want you to hear this, because there's too many Christians, too many people at church, let's put it this way, that go to church that say, I don't have this life that you guys keep talking about. I want you to know there's only life in you when there's life in you. If the baby dies, there's no more life in you. Get it? The Christ is deposited in us as a seed, the Bible says. But if we aren't intentional with our prenatal care, if that seed dies in us, the life just died in us. We're still Christians. We still go to church. We tithe. We serve. We stopped cussing. We didn't return back to that. But we're empty. Why are we empty? Because there's something in us that is not alive. We abort. We have miscarriages. We have malnutritioned fetuses because we don't feed the Christ that's in us. We don't nurture that thing that's in us. We are so stinking flippant in the American church anymore. We want everything the first century church had. We try to have signs and wonders and miracles by preaching about signs and wonders and miracles. Like, that's really going to work. So what we do is we force it. And we get things all stirred up, and we shimmy, and we shake, and we put our hands on each other, and we knock each other down on the floor, and we do all kinds of crazy stuff, because we're trying to force a miracle here. And we take things that are no more a miracle than me getting over a head cold in a week, and we tell the great story of what God just did in us. Because what's wrong with us if there's no signs and wonders and miracles? And we try to force these things. And the first century church had these things. They saw these things. And it was bigger than miracles. It was mass evangelism. The church grew daily. Not like the American church where everyone's scrambling trying to keep their chairs filled. But these were people who did with the spirit man what they were doing with the natural man. They met daily. How many of you guys eat once a week? Twice a week, for those that come on Wednesday night. We have malnourished fetuses, and they're beginning to deform. And even if we carry that thing full term, when we push it out, we end up with some kind of Frankenstein. Something that's a little bit of Jesus, a little bit of law, a little bit of method, a little bit of technique, a little bit of this denomination, a little bit of that denomination. It's not life. It's just confusion and dysfunctionality. Because we're flippant in the American church. We go to church when we're in the mood. We go to church when we feel like it. And we say, well, but we've got these strong devotional lives. And I'm glad that you guys do, because if you do, that means you've broke all the studies that's out there that says that there's less than 3% of Christians in America that has a legitimate devotional life. We don't feed the baby, so the baby's malnourished now, and things aren't growing the way they should be. But the preacher said, but if I'd give my heart to Jesus and let him come in, I'd have all this rainbows and hummingbirds flying through my life, and just everything would be beautiful. Where's the life? We're not intentional I love the newest one where, well, Sunday's our new family day. You got something against Saturday? We fool ourselves saying, but we don't have any other time, so we're going to take these times and we sacrifice our prenatal care for something of much less significance. We abort, we have miscarriages, we have malnourished fetuses, we have premature births where we're so fed into by the church machine in America where you got saved and now instantly we throw people out into to the wolves and you got to start doing this and doing that. I'll never forget I call it the B.J. Thomas syndrome. Anybody here old enough to know who B.J. Thomas is? Thank you for the four of you that just raised your hands. B.J. Thomas was like one of the first ones who was like real famous that got saved. Because he was so famous and so well known, buddy, you need to start preaching like tomorrow. And so we took the little baby fetus Jesus that was in him, and we say, you need to push this thing out tomorrow. It needs to be activated immediately because, boy, look at the stage you've got and the people that'll listen to you. The dude was dumber than a rock when it came to God, didn't know anything about what God was trying to do anywhere in the earth, much less himself. And he got out there and he flamed up and he flamed out, and before he knew it, he was in worse shape than he was. Premature birth. And it goes back to the same problem with malnutrition. We don't take the time to let that which God has now put in us as life to nourish it and disciple it and teach it and stick it in relationships with fellowship. You guys, if you haven't got it yet, stick around. You're going to get it at some point. Why I keep pushing fellowship, 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 fellowship. Where do I get that from? Jesus, 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 Jesus. Him and the disciples, hanging out, eating food, traveling on little journeys together. It was always about being together. And I've told you before, if you can ever just get in a big room together and do whatever, you'd be amazed what'll happen. There's something about when body parts come together, even if they're just playing volleyball, if they're on a picnic, they're eating a hot dog together. There's something about when body parts get in the same vicinity, things happen. People start encouraging each other and prophesying to each other and praying for each other and caring for each other because they get to know each other. So when you say, Brother John just lost his father. Oh, John's such an awesome guy. I love that guy so much. And now it's the fervent, effectual prayers because I have effectual feelings for John because I know him and I'm hurting for him because he's hurting. And now my prayer, man, is shaking the heavens and it's stirring something in the earth. Unlike the token prayers that we give because we don't know each other. There's a deposit in us. Is it going to form? Is it going to get pushed out? Is it going to produce? Today it comes down to which dog you're going to feed. Look here in Romans 8. Let me put a wrapper on this thing for now. Those who live according to the sinful nature have their mind set on what that nature desires. Where's your mind at? Man, at the last second we get up, we brush our teeth and we comb our hair, we throw our clothes on and we rush to get to church. We got something else on our mind the whole time we're there. We hurry up to get out of church so we can be the first at the restaurant. I'm not talking about Cornerstone. I'm talking about America. What's on our mind? Say, well, it's not sinful stuff. I'm not thinking about having an affair or anything like that. Sinful stuff, it means missing the mark. The Bible says there's one target, Jesus Christ. What's sin? Anything that misses that mark. So we live according to the sinful nature because we have our mind set on what that nature desires, flesh. It may be something just wanting to prosper more or have more of this or more of that or do more of this. It could be a lot of things. It's about the nature, what nature desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. And somehow we've grown up in an American church where all that seems very hard, labor-intensive, and even boring. And I'm here to tell you, if you ever start truly dabbling in those waters, you're going to find just the opposite. You're going to find righteousness, peace, joy, and life, and where now the things you do in the natural suddenly get that much better. Continue on real quick. The mind of sinful man is death. but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. You, however, are controlled not by the sinful nature, but by the Spirit. If the Spirit of God lives in you, and if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, your body is dead because of sin, yet your spirit is alive because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who lives in you. And let me explain to you, the story is painted no better than with the very death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The literal death of a carnal body going into the grave, but coming out of that grave, out of that man. I love the picture we have in the lobby out here. If you've never looked at it, the bulletin board, look at it on your way out. I love that picture of the new man breaking out of the crust of that old man. That's the born again experience. That's the what Paul, especially in the book of Romans, mostly deals with, these two wolves. And feeding the spirit man, becoming intentional to let the spirit man take dominance now, precedence, dominion, power in your earth, take authority over the sinful man. And when you do that, Paul says, the consequence is going to be even life now to your mortal body. Here's what we do in America, whether it's with church or with a bigger screen TV or a new car, or a new job, a new husband, a new wife, whatever it may be that we're getting new and improved for our lives, we're doing it trying to bring life to our mortal body, our mortal life. He's saying, if you do that, it's just going to die. Said, but if you will nourish the spirit man, if you will cater to the spirit man, the Christ that's in you growing, he said, the end result will actually even be life to your mortal bodies. You will actually find the evidence of the new man showing up in your old man. What does it mean? It means suddenly you're finding that you are disciplining yourself without trying to discipline yourself. Suddenly you are more restrained and in you've got more self-control, and you're not struggling with some of these things. I did not stop becoming an alcoholic because I tried to stop becoming an alcoholic. I had tried that for a while. I learned to cater to the Christ in me. He increased, I decreased. Desires changed, natures changed, behaviors changed, attitudes changed. It'll even bring life to your mortal body. Life to your mortal body. Let's finish this up with 1 Peter 2:11. So you people that read your bulletin can at least look at the front cover, can make sense. Dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world to abstain from sinful desires, which wars against your soul. It's all about what you're feeding. I want you to understand why now that Peter calls us aliens, and why Jesus says we're not of this world. It has nothing to do with escaping someday in some rapture, going off to heaven and live somewhere in the sky. It has nothing to do with any of that. It's talking about right here, right now, we're not of the kingdom of the world, we're of the kingdom of God. We're aliens in the world, because in the world is the systems of flesh. It's the systems of the natural man. So that's not our world. We're aliens here. We're in the world, but we're not of the world. We're aliens. We have a new world now, and a new world leader. We need to start living like aliens. We need to birth it out, man. We need to push it out. Is it hard to give birth? Yes. I'm not a woman, but I have Discovery Channel. And I've seen things that I've tried to stop seeing, and it's still in there now. And some of you husbands have been, you've done the right thing by going in that labor room, and you've come out with the scars to prove it. You've taken your cussings and you've taken your nails and Yeah, it's hard. It's easier to not be pregnant. It's easier to keep that nice little skinny twiggy body and never have to worry about what carrying a child is going to do to your figure, making you miserable in the summer and water retention and all those wonderful things. The price tag that comes with bearing life. It's easier to not have the responsibility of a child in your life. Go do what you want. I've told you before that just before we went to China to get Hannah, that a year and a half before that, I'm sitting there going, okay, my dream car's always been a 42 Willys coupe. And I've got, it's like the angel on one shoulder and the devil on the other. Only I got a Chinese baby on one shoulder and a 42 Willys coupe on the other. It's easier to not have a child and have a 42 Willys coupe. But it's not even remotely the same level of life now, is it? Because as much as we complain on some days with our kids, oh my gosh, does it take life to a new level of abundance? I have been grieving coming into the school term because of the lack of experience and time that I am not having with my daughter that I once had. Those of you that have recently lost kids to college, I just want to give y'all a big hug right now and say, look, I'll grieve with you. I'm not even there yet, and the sorrow has already set in. Because when you birth life, now you have life. I want you to stand with me this morning. I made y'all come up here last week. We had 300 salvations last week. It was a glorious day at Cornerstone Family Church. I bragged to all my pastor buddies. I said, I had to kick it up. So did y'all have a good church service last week? Yeah, it was okay. One guy said, yeah, it was one of the worst services we ever had. One guy said, we didn't even have hardly one at church. I don't know what was going on. And then I felt like, oh, I'm just not going to say anything. He said, well, what about you guys? Was it just a bad day for you guys too? I said, so I don't mean to brag, but we had 300 people get saved Sunday morning. Guys, you'll have to be intentional with this, or you're going to be like Nicodemus. You're just going to be religious. You're going to go through the system. You're going to paint by the numbers, and you're going to hit old age. My heart, if you saw the church sign out there, we do believe Jesus is coming, and hopefully before the election. But if he doesn't, then what's the point? He can linger forever at that point. If you have been trapped in that old thing of just, well, I said the sinner's prayer and now I'm just holding on for dear life till he comes back or whatever, you have missed entirely this whole story of God and what he's trying to do. He wants you to have life right here, right now. Life only happens because that egg, that spirit egg that's been dormant inside of you has now been ignited by the deposit of seed that he's placed inside of you. And now you have to become intentional to nourish that thing, guard that thing, feed that thing, disciple that thing, fellowship that thing, activate that thing, serve that thing, worship with that thing. You got to become intentional. And it will grow. And I promise you that everything that the Bible promises for you, you will find, but it's not going to be in the identity of the old man that's just trying to discipline itself with religion. It won't happen. That's just prison on top of prison. It's only going to happen because you allow the new man, the Christ man, to birth. You'll have to be intentional. Father, today, I pray for this house. First of all, I pray for anyone here, Lord, that is heard the teaching of your word today and something has been stirring inside of them. They would be like those men on the road to Emmaus, Lord. They would be like the people who would sit and hear the words of Jesus. They would be in a situation today where on this journey, something very huge is happening. I pray today, Lord, with them, as they would say, Father, I release the will of my life to you. I give my life to you today for you to impart into my life, for you to make deposits into my life. Lord, I welcome the seed of the Spirit today. Birth in me a new man. We welcome those deposits today, Lord, and we give our lives to you. Father, for all of us, help us to become more intentional. Help us to want to become more intentional. Lord, we're battling with wanting to really serve you. We want to go to heaven, but we battle wanting to serve you and wanting to read the Bible and wanting to pray and wanting to lift our hands in worship and wanting to serve and wanting to tithe. Lord, we're battling stuff that makes no sense if it's the new man. Help us to become intentional. Thank you for what you're doing this season at Cornerstone Family Church, Lord. We're going to flow with you like the Spirit, the wind. It's going to blow here and blow there. I ain't going to try to get ahead of you. I'm going to try not to get behind you. We ain't going to try to put our hands on it and dabble it and say, we've got it from here, Lord. We're going to flow with you every Sunday morning, every Wednesday night. We're going to flow with you and see where your Ruah takes us, because we know you've got a plan in place at this house right now. We give you praise for it. Amen. Agree with all that? I love you guys. Bless you. Go in peace.